Magandang hapon sa inyong lahat. Good evening. Thank you all for coming. This is a big deal for me. I graduated not too long ago, and I'm a newly minted assistant professor, as Anthony said. And so my presentations have typically been in academic settings with few Filipinos. And so this is really exciting. And it also admittedly brings up a lot of feelings. So in New York City, as Anthony said, I was a public school teacher and community organizer, working alongside many of you in this room. I went back to school to do my PhD in order to research and share community stories to my community, our community. And so this is like coming full circle. For those who are new to Filipino history, if there's anything that I want to leave you here knowing, it is that Filipinos have a long legacy of organizing against injustice in the US and abroad, and that LGBT people have been on the front line of doing this work for centuries. I want to acknowledge the Lenape people whose land we are occupying right at this very moment, as well as the Mohegan and Pequot people whose land I currently live on in what is now called New London, Connecticut. I acknowledge the Chumash people whose land I lived on when I was pursuing my degree and gaining knowledge to help me with this project in what is now called Santa Barbara, California. I was born and raised on Lenape land in what is now called New Jersey. I'm the daughter of Maria Luisa Buenavista Hanna, originally of Bacolod Negros Occidental in the Philippines. She's the daughter of Florentino and Flora Buenavista, whose lineage is Hiligaynon, Panay, Bukidnon, Maspeteño, and Pangasinanse. My father, Ben Hanna, hails from what is known today as Chiang Mai, Thailand, and he is the son of Ting Seng Eng and Sai Tiang Tang, whose lineage is from what's now known as Guangdong in the Chaoan province of China. In addition to the land, my lineage, and my ancestors, I want to acknowledge some other people. First, Dr. Inez Talamantes, who is an Apache, Apache elder who left us and transitioned to the spirit world not very long ago, and whose lessons still stay with me. I also want to acknowledge Russell Leong and Anthony Wong, who invited me and were the ones who solicited me to write this article that this talk is based on. Funny story, 2.5 years ago, I was sitting next to Anthony on a flight to Portland, Oregon for the Asian American Studies Conference. We didn't know each other. As per usual, as the grad students in this room know, it was like the day before the conference and I was scrambling to finish my presentation on the plane. And meanwhile, apparently Anthony was texting Russell, the editor of CUNY Forum, about my work, which he was looking over my shoulder apparently and saw the slides say KDP. So at the end of the ride, he introduced himself and I was surprised, and he said he was in touch with Russell on that plane, and they wanted me to contribute to their journal potentially. So, as I said, I was surprised, but also floored really because of my huge respect to Russell, who has been the longtime editor of Amerasia Journal in LA, and that's actually where he is right now. I wish he could be here. And he's given so much to the Asian American community. So really, it's a huge honor to be asked to contribute to the journal. I was also then a graduate student without much experience in the field. So I really, truly am grateful for their support. I also want to thank Dr. Enrique De La Cruz, who offered generous and critically constructive comments as a reviewer of the article. And lastly, really foremost, I need to express gratitude to all of the activists in the the KDP, who helps me understand and continue to help me understand the culture of KDP. And so these are the members that I was fortunate enough to speak with. But individually, I would like to thank Jaime Guiaga, Dr. Trinity Ordonia, Bruce Oxenia, Dr. Estela Habal, John Silva, Ia Rodriguez, and others who have asked me not to name them, but who shared their stories with me. They responded to drafts. They provided insight in a personalized way that really only they could give because they themselves had lived this history. I especially want to acknowledge Trinity Ordonia and Gil Mangawang, whose writing about being gay in the KDP and the broader US left I draw on in this article and in my work. And lastly, I honor the late Ermina Van Luan, who is framed over on the right side of the table over there. She really helped me fact check and write with that greater nuance and richness that this organization deserves. Before she passed way too soon, anyone who knew her here would know that she was such a youthful spirit, that she died well before her time. She was a skilled documentarian as well as an incredibly generous human being. Because of political transfers and personal moves, there are only a couple of New York City based KDP activists today, and unfortunately they weren't able to attend. As much as my wish is to ground these stories that I tell in the voices of the original participants, this is impossible, right? I'm a filter to their stories. And so I want to remind you of that. And I say that to also convey to you with full transparency in feminist praxis that this research has been quite challenging because the participants are living and breathing and have their stories to tell in their own ways. And it's been difficult to navigate that, but at the same time also very beautiful because it centers that back and forth process of relationality, centers the sense of kapwa, which is the Filipino indigenous value of I am you, you are me, we are the same. When I first went to grad school, I was interested in questions of gendered labor and histories of feminism in the Asian American movement, the 1970s, the 60s and 70s. I was so, enamored by that period of time, as many people are. At the same time as being interested in that time period, my questions also came from experiences and observations that I made with a collective that I worked with, that with many of you here in this room, of Filipino immigrant domestic workers and immigrant young people in New York City from 2006 to 2011. What we observed was that using a class and race-based organizing framework didn't consider the impacts of gender and sexuality on our analysis, despite the fact that so many of us were women and or identified as queer. So I wanted to see if our experiences were unique to us, or if they also existed beyond us. And so for my master's research, I conducted an ethnographic research project in which I interviewed activists around these questions in New York City in the Filipino community. And what I found was that women, queer people, trans activists in other organizations like us had struggled with the same contradictions that we were. And many people, in fact, had left their organizations because of that, those contradictions that weren't speaking to the real lived experiences in their lives. Some cited sexism, some cited transmisogyny and homophobia in a straight and cisgender dominated movement in their words. And so I want to make clear, too, that, you know, this isn't unique to the Filipino community. This problem of heterosexism, transmisogyny, you know, is everywhere in society and has been internalized by activists and, you know, those who are not working for social change too, right? It's something that we live and breathe. And so we are not unique, but still have our own unique particularities. I wondered, as I was interested in the 1960s and 70s, whether our elders had thought about these contradictions too, and what they had done to address them. So I did some digging. In 2012, I found very little documentation about feminist analyses during the Asian American movement. But the most surprising thing was that there was a scarcity of record of Filipinos during that time. And you can see up here on the screen several people who had written short essays referencing the anti-imperialist activism of Filipinos in the 1970s and 80s, Helen Toribio, Gil Mangawang, Ninochka Roska, Delia Aguilar, Carol Ojeda Kimbrough. Estella Habal had written a book about the international hotel struggle. Trinity Ordonia had written her important dissertation about API queer women's and trans people's involvement in San Francisco. And then finally, Ligaya Domingo, the daughter of Terry Mast and Silme Domingo, had just finished her dissertation about Filipino radicalism in Seattle. And so it may seem like, okay, that's a lot of people, but it really isn't. And it also, more importantly, reflects a scattered historiography that existed, that actually reflects a lot of the division that still continues in our movements today. The stories that they represent and the perspectives that they took first as firsthand activists represented their own organizations, but didn't talk across organization to allow for a more comprehensive history of the progressive Filipino movement in the US post-60s. And this is despite Filipinos being the second largest Asian group in the US with a rich history of resistance here. And so that's when my project really emerged, and that's where it's rooted from. I decided to track not only the KDP, but also other anti-imperialist Filipino formations rooted in the anti-Marcos movement, which I will tell you more about. These groups include the National Committee for the Restoration of Civil Liberties in the Philippines, and that particular chapter in LA, Pintig Cultural Group in Chicago, and the National Formation Alliance for Philippine Concerns. As a feminist studies scholar, I am also interested in in addition to documenting this history, how ideas about gender and sexuality travel and change across time and space. So in my work, I'm tracing the politics of the anti-Marcos movement from 1968 to Marcos's ousting from power in 1986, and then continue to trace it into what some scholars call Marcos's afterlives. Indeed, traces of the violence of the Marcos period remain in people's lives today in material and emotional ways. Unfortunately, we see this connection even more starkly than I could have even imagined when I started my research in 2011, given the return of the Marcos family to power in the Philippines, the friendly relations between now President Rodrigo Duterte and the Marcos family that has really sought to erase the violence of the Marcos period from historical memory. For the remainder of the talk, I'm going to share with you a brief history of the organization of KDP, Katipunan ng mga Demokratikong Pilipino, which was arguably the most militant Filipino organization in the US in the 1970s. I'm going to talk about what the KDP was and what they fought against and what they built. And then I'll discuss how the movement's LGBT politics shifted over time. And yes, to remind you, LGBT people were on the front lines of doing that work. And I will talk to you about what some of those experiences of those leaders were. And then I will wrap up by outlining some connections and lessons for today. The KDP, the Tagalog version, Katipunan ng mga Demokratikong Pilipino, means in English, roughly, the Union for Democratic Filipinos. It was founded in 1973, a year after Ferdinand Marcos declared martial law in the Philippines. Leading up to Marcos's declaration of martial law had been a rise of mass protests over the Philippines' worsening economic conditions and political situation. To quell opposition, Marcos declared martial law, which was a time of intense political repression carried out through mass extrajudicial killings, political imprisonment, and torture. Marcos's opponents, some of whom would become members of KDP, criticized the Philippines' neo-colonial relationship with the US and Marcos's role in that relationship. And this may be something I don't need to do because so many of you are familiar, but I will anyway, for the newcomers, give you a Philippine-US History 101. This is so that you can understand the critiques of KDP. The US formally colonized the Philippines in 1898. It was ceded from Spain along with Cuba, Puerto Rico, and Guam through the Treaty of Paris in exchange for $20 million. Filipinos didn't allow themselves to be colonized without a fight and resisted through the Philippine-American War, which some scholars refer to as the First Vietnam. The result was over 1 million dead Filipinos, and this is a brutal image on the left of some of those Filipinos, including children, who were viewed as a threat. The US government perfected its methods of torture, all under the guise of benevolence, paternalism, and quote unquote civilization. The US government and business owners exploited its new colony, taking advantage of Filipinos as a cheap labor source through its agricultural and salmon canning industries in particular. Yet Filipinos continued their legacy of resistance. They became fierce union leaders and nationalists organizing for Philippine sovereignty. And I want to point out to you, Little Manila is in the Heart, which is a phenomenal resource for learning about that history of Filipino farm workers, written by the late Dr. Don Mabalon, who is framed on the left side of the table here, coincidentally the same summer that Ermina passed, Don did as well. Their nationalist efforts led the US government to allow the Philippines to transition to independence starting in 1936, but with stipulations. For example, Philippine leaders were groomed to copy the American political and economic system. So in 1946, the US government granted the Philippines independence, but of course, this was on the US's terms, to ostensibly assist the Philippines in its recovery from World War II, US Congress passed the Bell Trade Act, solidifying the two countries' neocolonial relationship that really continues today. The act placed, for example, preferential tariffs on US goods imported to the Philippines. It fixed the exchange rate between the Philippines peso and the US dollar, and it also allowed for what's called parity rights, which are equal rights between U.S. citizens and Filipinos involving ownership of utilities and natural resources. Lastly, in 1947, the Military Bases Agreement gave the U.S. military access to the Philippines naval bases. So you can see that in these ways, even though the Philippines was no longer an official colony to the United States, it remains economically and politically and militarily dependent on the United States. It was this history that the founding members of KDP learned about as young college students in the Philippines in the late 60s and early 70s. And so it was educating others about this history and dismantling this neo-colonial relationship that was the basis for the insurgency that KDP engaged in. Ferdinand Marcos furthered the Philippines' dependence on the U.S. when he was in power. During the martial law period, he issued numerous labor codes, he merged government agencies, he pushed manufacturing export programs, and established overseas contract worker agreements with other nations, all of which prioritized workers' export rather than investing in national industry and sustainable agriculture or sustainable infrastructure. At the same time, Marcos also amassed enormous human rights violations with a total population of between 42 and 48 million people between 1975 and 1980. It's estimated that Marcos's years in power, the majority of which were supported by the U.S. government, led to over 3,000 extrajudicial killings, 35,000 torture victims, 70,000 people incarcerated, and at least 750 activists who have not been found to this day. This dangerous climate of martial law compelled an undetermined number of young activists, some of whom would become leaders of KDP, to move to the U.S. in the 1970s and the 80s. For example, Melanie Santos, and this is a pseudonym as she asked me not to name her, was one of those young activists who moved. As a teen, Santos had been politicized by anti-Vietnam protests in Madison, Wisconsin, and she was one of the members of the first Cuban Venceremos Brigades, where she learned about the Filipino revolutionary movement on the radio. You see her move here. She was the child of a Filipino father and a white mother, and she was inspired to contribute to what she viewed as her revolution. And so after hearing about it on the radio in Cuba, she moved to the Philippines to join the guerrilla movement at the age of 18. She was over here. Immediately after Marcos declared martial law, Santos was captured. She was imprisoned, and then she was deported back to the U.S. But the movement connected her with allies who asked her to discuss the political situation in the Philippines, all over the country, on speaking tours. And so within 2 years of her return back to the U.S., she had connected with other Filipinos and non-Filipinos who were concerned about the worsening situation in the Philippines, and together they created the KDP in the Bay Area in 1973. So from 1973 to 1986, KDP built 9 chapters in cities across the U.S., from Seattle to New York to Guam to Chicago, and they also created a Canadian formation called IAFP. Its leadership consisted of a 9-member national council and executive board based in the Bay Area, and regional and chapter executive boards in various cities. So it was quite sophisticated in its infrastructure. It was local, it was transnational, and it was radical. And it had 2 main goals: one, to fight for socialism in the US, and 2, to support the revolutionary movement in the Philippines, which was working to establish not only ousting Marcos from power, but national sovereignty for the Filipino people. KDP's work locally included fighting for bilingual education in schools, labor reforms for Filipino medical professionals at risk for deportation, so nurses, for example. They worked with exploited Filipino, Native, and Black cannery workers, and they also had participated in the decades-long campaign to stop forced evictions of elderly Asian Americans in San Francisco, otherwise known as the International Hotel Struggle. So I have actually the book over there that was written by Dr. Estella Habal, which goes in great detail, and I encourage you to read that book as well. The KDP, you know, there were just countless initiatives that they were a part of, and those were just some of them. They were ardent internationalists who also led the formation of an anti-martial law coalition, the AMLC, which launched in 1975. So this was a broad-based coalition of organizations all across the country, and together they educated the American public about Marcos, and they led demonstrations, they lobbied the U.S. government to end its aid to the Marcos government. They also partnered with labor unions in the Philippines to expose the exploitative working conditions there as well as here, to make that connection, that internationalist labor solidarity unity. And given that some of its members were part of the Communist Party of the Philippines, the party held great influence on the ideological formation and programs of KDP up until their official split in 1986. KDP's leaders were theoreticians who required their members to participate in annual theoretical training schools. They published a monthly theoretical bulletin as well as a national newspaper for over a decade. So that's a lot of work. Those of you who do this work, I think, can really respect that. That's a lot of work to print out, to write, print out, crank out the copies, pass them out, sell them. On Katipunan right here, the third picture is that newspaper that they wrote and sold. The KDP had a cultural arm as well, recognizing the importance of cultural work, and their group that did the cultural work was called Sining Bayan. And the last picture is a picture of their one of their record albums that they put out. Ermina was the director of Sining Bayan and was very prolific in leading, writing, producing these political plays that toured the country. KDP also developed their own housing collectives and childcare system so that parents could participate in organizing. And they were among the first in the New Left to articulate theoretical connections between capitalism and heterosexuality. And so now I really could stop here, because just knowing that is such a disruption into mainstream history, right? Filipinos, Asian Americans are just thought in memory to be docile, passive, right? And so it's just so important for the young people here and elsewhere to locate themselves in histories of resistance that tend to lie in a black-white binary and render invisible these kinds of stories. But I'd like to go deeper. I am a community-raised scholar, and so I am interested in how political ideas evolve and change within organizations, as well as learning about these histories on the outset. Historian Robin Kelly calls for researchers of people of color movements to uncover what James C. Scott calls the hidden transcripts, the infrapolitics, or the daily acts of struggle that have a cumulative effect on power relations. So often it is the work of women and LGBT people whose actions lie beneath the radar of traditional histories of resistance. In Chicana Power, Maylee Blackwell describes the work of Chicana activists who deployed what she calls the multiple feminist insurgencies of social movements. And so what she argues is that if we only identify feminist acts as happening within women's groups and LGBT organizations, what we miss are the multiple struggles that occur within one movement and the ways that people worked in and between movements. And so for me, one of the most compelling features of the KDP is that many of its leaders were women and or gays or lesbians. And so in fact, Melanie Santos is one of two of its three founding members who identify today as LGBT. That LGBT people could hold leadership positions in the KDP was unique compared to other revolutionary nationalist organizations in the Third World Left at the time. And that includes the Black Panther Party, that includes the Young Lords, and all of the groups in the Asian American movement. And so, I still stand by this statement that LGBT people have been on the front lines, because even though you weren't allowed to be in those groups, we know now that many of those leaders in those groups were LGBT, they just couldn't be out at the time. So I wondered, was it true though that KDP was more sexually progressive than its third world counterparts? And if so, why? So what I did is I sought out as many LGBT KDP members as I could find to answer the question. And just as an aside, as someone who at that time was questioning my sexual identity and starting to identify as queer, interviewing, getting in touch with and interviewing these older LGBT activists who were Filipino was really a life-giving experience for me. Out of the almost 40 KDP members that I interviewed, about one-fourth of that group disclosed that they now identify as either gay, lesbian, bisexual, or questioning. So the stories that I gathered reveal that, in a way, maybe we could say yes to that question, but hearing their stories reveals that the answer is a lot more complicated than saying yes. Also, just a note about terms. I do drop the Q on purpose when discussing the past to say LGBT versus LGBTQ, as we tend to do today, because the people I interviewed themselves, most of them don't refer to themselves as queer. They either refer themselves as gay, lesbian, bisexual, or gay for short. Or LGBT, like that's the phrase that they use, LGBT. Some bisexual members identified as straight in the 70s because they weren't out, and at that time period, the word bisexual wasn't in common use. All of the people that I interviewed were all either L, G, or B. There was one trans person that I was told about, but I wasn't able to locate. Hearing the stories of these folks, the LGBTs in KDP, showed to me that there was a shift from the 70s in which the KDP was founded to when it dissolved in the mid-1980s. I'm going to talk to you about the stories in stages historically. I think stages is helpful because it helps us to see change over time and identify some of the historical markers that shape the reason that people act the way that they do. But of course, we want to keep in mind that there is a simplicity that comes with that I think is important to point out. They weren't just stuck in these different stages, obviously. There was overlap, there's dynamism, there's fluidity between the stages, and then there's also differences, too, between the different chapters. So as I said, that there were nine chapters. So you know, what's more important to me than dates is that, and I want to convey to you, is that the KDP's politics really emerged out of these existing movements and then were impacted by these other influences, which I will describe to you in more detail, okay? So the early 1970s, this was when the KDP was founded, was a time when most of the old and the new lefts believed homosexuality was a, quote, bourgeois perversion. They were influenced by several factors: the Soviet Union's Communist Party, and particularly Fidel Castro's then stance in Cuba. As I said earlier, several leaders of KDP, including Melanie Santos, had been members of the Venceremos Brigades in Cuba. And the brigade offered activists this amazing experience of socialism firsthand. But at the same time, it also exposed them to a revolutionary paradigm that stigmatized homosexuality. And then they brought that back to the US. Gays in Cuba were read as, quote, subjective, because they deviated from the, quote, material conditions of maleness, and thus lacked clarity and directedness. Meanwhile, female same-sex desire was completely dismissing from the analysis at all. It was invisible, primarily in the discourse. The activists, too, were influenced by the Communist Party of China, which viewed homosexuality as bourgeois decadence. And according to Mao, quote, like prostitution and pornography, homosexuality would disappear with the advance of socialism. So this was happening in sort of the movement before KDP was formed. And a lot of the activists were involved in other groups, including Sally. And Sally is a pseudonym. She's a Filipino-American lesbian. And she described her experience in the Asian American movement. So you can see, prior to the formation of KDP, being gay was so highly stigmatized that activists who were attracted to people of the same sex lived, like Sally, a double life. They either had to live a double life within their activist circles or were forced to leave upon outing themselves. And so this is a picture of Project Manong, which was an Oakland housing initiative for Filipino elders in the early 70s. And it was one of the pre-KDP Filipino initiatives that Sally was a part of. So in this way, the new left mirrored the right. The US government itself had purged gay state employees as, quote, security risks in the 50s under McCarthy. And so it was within this context that KDP was formed in 1973. It was unique to other groups, which just, if you were out sexually, then you were out of the group. But with KDP in this time, it operated in a sort of don't ask, don't tell policy. As young adults in their early 20s, some KDP members grappled with sexual identity and expression. According to Trinity Ordonia, when Melanie Santos started a same-sex relationship with her in 1973, their fellow comrades in the National Council were supportive. They were either navigating their own questions about sexuality, or they had siblings themselves who were gay. But they feared that Melanie Santos's homosexuality would be used against the organization by the right and the left to discredit it. And so it was decided amongst them that Melanie would not go public about her her same-sex relationship. When they did come out to the entire KDP soon after, their comrades were generally supportive, but at the same time, it still wasn't openly discussed. And anthropologist Joanna Palomar, who some of us in this room know as Anang, has talked about this dynamic as being very culturally Filipino. In the Philippines, a family might know that their child is gay or a lesbian, but not ostracize them. But they also won't talk about it as long as you're a productive member of the household, bringing home a paycheck. So in this way, even though KDP didn't have a policy for hiding sexuality, members tended to censor themselves for acceptance, even though everybody, quote unquote, knew. John Silva, an out gay Filipino immigrant, moved to the US after a bad breakup with his boyfriend to attend UC Berkeley. He'd been a member of Philippines La Salle University and its chapter of SDK, which was an anti-Marcos student organization in the Philippines. Once in the US, Silva became a founding member of KDP in 1973. Given its don't ask, don't tell culture, no one else at that time openly identified as gay or lesbian. Thus, he identifies himself as one of KDP's first out members. And I should also say that he also was a member of one of the Venceremos brigades and actually wasn't out when he was in Cuba. But when he came back in a place where he felt more of his own organizing space, he chose to be out. And he remembers it being very hard. He recalls KDP leaders who encouraged him to subsume his sexuality under the, quote, primary contradiction of proletariat versus the ruling class. But Silva didn't want to live his gay life separately from KDP. So after internally struggling with the leadership, Silva eventually decided to leave KDP around 1975. It's interesting to note that, like the Black feminists of the Combahee River Collective, Silva was using an intersectional politic that sees multiple oppression as interlocking and connected before Kimberly Crenshaw, who's typically cited for using the term, coined it in 1983. After John left the KDP in the mid to late 1970s, one could be out within the KDP, but also was strategic about how they expressed their sexuality outside of the organization. There wasn't explicit support for LGBT members, but there also wasn't opposition. And this is a quote from a Japanese-American lesbian who wasn't in KDP, was in another organization in the Asian American movement, but was not able to come out. It was a secret that she was a lesbian. And this is what she said. So because of KDP's stature and rampant homophobia in the Asian American movement, there were heavy pressures to maintain the reputation of being exceptionally, quote, grim and determined. And this is a phrase that was common at that time within the left. Pressures of exceptionalism were high for KDP's leaders, and especially if one was a gay male, like Bruce Oxenia, who was not a straight male. From combating racism from white leftists, homophobia from comrades of color, and the expectations of a traditionally masculine leadership, it was easy to get buried in the work, and as one member put it, to lose your sexuality. So the Maoist motto of serving the people was the guiding force between their drive as exceptional activists. The hardworking and selfless ethic compounded by homophobia in the left and racism in the gay movement created a double-edged sword for Filipino activists exploring their sexual identities, which essentially became compartmentalized. So they were either gay or they were Filipino. Some ended up even marrying comrades of the opposite sex, then separating and coming out later. This dynamic mirrored the Communist Party of the Philippines, which highly influenced the KDP members, some of whom were trained by the CPP itself, including Melanie Santos. And the culture for gay people in the CPP was similar to the don't ask, don't tell, and lose your sexuality climate that KDP maintained. KDP leaders trained in the Philippine Revolution, like Melanie Santos herself, an emerging lesbian, I argue exported the CPP's culture around homosexuality and unintentionally applied it to the KDP. So in 2016, I went to the Netherlands, where several CPP leaders and former party members reside, and I asked them how they remembered the party's views on homosexuality in the 1970s. Unlike the Third World and Cuban lefts, LGBT radicals were allowed in the Communist Party of the Philippines and were very active in the party in the 1970s and the 80s. But as the people I interviewed told me, stereotypes did persist, with gay males, quote, being laughed at, while lesbians were thought to be physically stronger than straight women and thus would be good soldiers. Senior party official Bonifacio Toledo, and that's a pseudonym, recalled how some party members interpreted homosexuality. So there's a lot to unpack here, which we don't have time to unpack at all. But here, partially unpacking it, he outlines a common party view that homosexuality is a product of bourgeois leisure. That is, that the true proletariat doesn't have time or interest in homosexuality. And so there's the common perspective that, you know, why would men think that they are women when they are men? And there it's assumed that because a person presents or was assigned male at birth, that fornication's only natural between him and a woman, or somebody that is assigned female at birth. These heterosexist binary gendered perspectives are not Filipino, okay? They're the product of colonial Spanish Catholic values and modern European and US sexology, which was brought to the Philippines through US colonial education programs and introduced during the colonial period in the Philippines. Just like in the Cuban left, some CPP members also saw gays as subjective, that they were untrustworthy because of their sexual desires. Those qualities compromise the character of a so-called good comrade, which trickled down into rules for gays organizing in rural areas. And Toledo said that the party knew it was wrong to humiliate gays and lesbians, yet it still restricted gay comrades from entering same-sex relationships based on the assumption and the fear that peasant families wouldn't entrust the party with their children otherwise. So, you might be wondering, with all of these pressures that the KDP LGBT activists were carrying, how did they assert and make space for their gay selves? And, you know, some, like John Silva, left the KDP, said, this is not for me. I'm going to do other things. Others stayed, and they shared various passive-aggressive ways, and this is using their words, of asserting their gay identities. For example, Gil Mangawang in LA writes about remembering how he would wear earrings and body jewelry, hinting that he might be gay, and he would flirt with uncomfortable straight male comrades who he lived with in the housing collectives. He also recalls engaging in sexual acts with another man in his shared housing collective while his more conservative straight comrades weren't home. And upon finding out, they were somewhat outraged, but still they didn't know how to address it. So it was a way of pushing back in his mind. Thankfully, there was no systematic way to address supposed sexual immorality in the KDP, but there were also no systematic ways to support gay comrades either. And so, for instance, when Gil Mangawang's lover died, he remembers most of his comrades not knowing what to do because it wasn't his girlfriend or his female spouse. So in times like this, straight members who were accepting of gays still didn't know how to concretely support their gay comrades. According to Ermina Vinluan, she said, so in addition to this, coming out was also challenging for those who identified as bisexual, because bisexuality was still gaining understanding in society. There was one tangible form of support that some gay members recall. And Jaime Giaga in LA and Cecilia Gonzalez, and that's a pseudonym, in Vancouver, both remember exploring their sexualities in the late 1970s, and they say that they were invited by other gay as well as straight ally leaders to transfer to the Bay Area chapter from where they were living. And so that move helped them to process their sexual identities, as the Bay was considered at that time the country's gay mecca, right? So they were, their comrades knew that they were going through this, and so wanted to support them by giving them a political transfer, which meant still having responsibilities in the Bay Area toward KDP, but also was encouraging them to seek out the support that they couldn't provide them within the organization. And so in this way, gays and lesbians form their own informal networks to survive. And for Giaga, the move also allowed him to go back to school, to be a physician's assistant, a career that would later save his life when he was diagnosed HIV positive in 1984. There is an amazing podcast, actually, of Jaime Giaga being interviewed called Long Distance Radio that was just released earlier this week that I encourage you all to listen to about Giaga's experiences. So in the late 1970s, the new right launched a series of offenses on the LGBT community, which pushed gay and lesbian concerns to the center of national debate. The propositions led straight leftists to take seriously the, quote, radical gay and lesbian arguments that sexual politics were interconnected with other structures of power. And Emily Hobson has done excellent work on this as well, not about Filipinos in particular, but about the third world left and LGBT people. KDP members were then not only able to be out, but they were also taking steps to theorize gay and lesbian struggles. And this coincided with the KDP's eventual split from the Maoist line of the CPP. KDP members moved into Line of March, which was a US-based pre-party Marxist-Leninist formation that sought to rectify the errors of the CPUSA. Line of March formed an official lesbian and gay commission in the mid-1980s. And this was all coinciding and is not surprising given that the AIDS crisis had then emerged and oppression against the LGBT community was becoming clearer to the mainstream. So for all of these reasons, it wasn't difficult for Filipina immigrant Ia Rodriguez to come out around 1979. In Seattle. So for Ia, it was harder to come out to her family in the Philippines than it was in the movement. Her experience contrasts that of John Silva from earlier, who came out as a young age in the Philippines, blurring binary framings of Philippine culture as either progressive or repressive about LGBT politics. This is a picture of the Coalition Against the Marcos Dictatorship, or CAMD, which Ia was a part of, as well as the Philippine Solidarity Network, which is on the right. And Ia says that the PSN, Philippine Solidarity Network, was full of lesbians. So like the New Left, the CPP eventually shifted its line on homosexuality. In March 1998, the CPP, no longer affiliated with the KDP, which had already dissolved in 1986, added a provision that forbade discrimination of comrades based on sexuality. So I, you know, there's a bunch to unpack here, but it still shows to me that there's this shift, right? And it's important to note that this approval of gay marriage happened before the U.S. repealed the Defense of Marriage Act in 2013, right? And it happened before gay marriage is legalized in the Philippines, which hasn't been still to this day. So even though it's not clear whether there have actually been changes in the party's political framework beyond a politics of inclusion, these changes to me still show that there's progress, and it indicates decades of struggle initiated by LGBT comrades in the party, much like the pushback in KDP. Many years, Fidel Castro, too, in Cuba, apologized for the treatment of LGBT people during the Cuban Revolution. So you see this shift across the board in many movements. And I don't want to set up a false progress narrative, so I just want to also add that in here. We know that people's behaviors don't change with policy, right? So during this last phase, this last stage, one lesbian member, for example, relayed a story to me about how she was going on a trip with another woman, her girlfriend, and some of the straight men leaders in KDP actually were incredulous and controlling, actually, and were opposing her going on this trip. It showed patriarchy, right, as well as homophobia, because the inkling to them was also, like, even though she didn't say it was her girlfriend, they guessed it. Some gays and lesbians left KDP and Line of March, not for antagonistic reasons, but because gay rights and the APIA AIDS work was really taking off, and so it became more central in their lives in comparison to the Philippine struggle, which was also important, but had to take sort of a secondary seat. There were others who also sought support that they couldn't find in the KDP, and they were criticized when they made time to take care of themselves. And that wasn't just the gay members, that was also the straight members. And one of the leaders, Bruce Oxenia, said that this was a weakness that they now acknowledge was a problem that was wrong. And it wasn't just KDP, I would add. It's a problem that plagues sort of the leftist organizational culture that I think is also shifting today. I think that knowing these histories in all its complexities is helpful, right, when we forge social justice paths new. And instead of reinventing the wheel, it can make us make sense of the current divisions, the reasons why people are leaving, right? They're still very much in line with what was happening 40 years ago. When the CPP and the KDP formally split in 1986, Ia Rodriguez, Gil Mangawang, Jaime Gayaga, and John Silva were well into their AIDS activism by that time. Gayaga, for example, had taken jobs coordinating the study of men's health and HIV/AIDS in 1985 after graduating from his physician's assistant program, and it was actually, because he was in that program, it led him to be at the forefront of AIDS research and treatment after becoming diagnosed HIV positive. Gayaga not only survived the AIDS crisis, but he became a stalwart in the gay community and APIA AIDS movement. Ultimately, his career path, being gay and the AIDS crisis, all took him in a direction away from the KDP. Yet the KDP also gave him tools to forge these new paths. I began this research about 8 years ago, and I, as I said, had no idea that it would become so relevant today. 33 years ago, when Marcos was ousted from power, 33 years later, after Marcos was ousted from power, we have seen a rise in a global right and a global left, not only here in the US, but also in the diasporic responses to Rodrigo Duterte, who many argue is developing a similar form of authoritarianism that Marcos used. I'm really appreciative, excited that anti-Marcos activists themselves are telling their stories in their own words, and A Time to Rise is sitting right there. That is a collection of stories that KDP members have published pretty recently. So please read their words in from their words. Read their stories from their words. It's promising. There's also a new wave of scholars who are working on this too, preserving these histories. Sharon Kinsett, Mark Sanchez, Michael Castaneda, Wayne Japanda, Joy Salas, myself. When young people ask how we can sharpen our movements forward or further, I think we can point to the multiple feminist insurgencies in KDP. We can see that global forces and personal circumstances produced LGBT and political identities that then created new spaces of belonging and resistance and led everyday people to shift in consciousness. We see, looking transnationally beyond the United States, that there was a movement of ideas about homosexuality in the US, Canada, Cuba, the Netherlands, the Philippines, that informed, that was informed by the networks that were forged by these activists who traversed these various countries. When we weave their histories together, we honor those whose presence and actions imagined and created pathways for liberatory politics, whose stories of struggle can disrupt cycles of heteronormativity and exclusion passed down intergenerationally to new activists. Together, we reject a model minority stereotype of Asian Americans, which curiously emerged in 1966, the same year that the Black Panther Party was formed, which furthers a black-white binary that erases the multiracial and internationalist history of resistance by Asian Americans in the United States. And that's important. And finally, we communicate to queer organizers of today that people like us were always present. We were always pushing back in movements of the past. Our current struggles are nothing new, and like our predecessors, we will continue to push back and push our movements forward. Thank you.